Is there a common thread that ties Forrest Fenn and Eric Sloane together with bombs? Yes, it's this book, Eric Sloane's Diary of an Early American Boy, Noah Blake, 1805. And aside from that fence border looking uncannily like a bomb, there are many other reasons, as you shall see. Eric wrote this book after he found a diary in an ancient house written by the 15-year-old Noah Blake. Eric is able to capture in story, dialogue, and sketches the daily events and mechanics of 1805 farm life that he derived from the entries in Noah's journal. He dedicates the book to his young niece because he was inspired by her enthusiasm over the diary. Diary of an Early American Boy, Noah Blake, 1805, is a true artistic masterpiece, a work surpassing perhaps even some of Da Vinci's finest on some levels, and it's easy to see why Forrest would have been in awe of Eric. Enough so, in my opinion, for this little book about a book to not only be the very thing that Forrest treasured most, I mean his true treasure, but also the vessel that holds the answers to the clues in his poem. The evidence for these somewhat bold statements will be presented primarily with passages and pictures from Diary of an Early American Boy, a few hints from The Thrill of the Chase, Too Far to Walk, and Once Upon a While, along with numerous hints from Forrest from various sources. All with as little input from me as possible. It all ties itself together. Let's get started. On February 4th, 2014, Forrest said, "When I told that story to my daughters, they laughed and reminded me of something I keep reminding myself, that I was born 100 years too late." In April of 2017, in scrapbook 173 posted on downneetzel.com, the last line Forrest writes in this scrapbook is, "Being a pioneer is really fun." Earlier on in the article, he also wrote, "So they tied Jose Tafoya to a wagon wheel and tortured him until he revealed where the Comanches were camped in Palo Duro." On November 3rd of 2012, Forrest said, "Well, you know, I had the bomb, but Newsweek magazine lit the fuse." November 2nd, 2013. Forrest said, "You know, I always figured the treasure chest was a bomb, but I didn't know it had a fuse until Dorothy came along." May 8th, 2017. Forrest said, "The military grabbed hold of me, and when I was 28 years old, I was a fighter pilot in the Air Force in Bitburg, Germany. The second day I was in Bitburg Air Force Base, they took me down to supply, and I signed a requisition for an atomic bomb. I owned that thing. It was on a dolly, and it had a crew chief. Like an airplane has a crew chief, but the bomb couldn't move an inch unless I was standing there supervising it." On January 17, 2015, on downneetzel.com, scrapbook 125, in an article called Firecracker, Forrest wrote, "School was out for the holidays, but all the kids were hanging around the social soda fountain at Smith's and waving past the firecracker stand. The second day, a couple of giggling girls walked up to flirt with the two enterprising businessmen. One purchased a fuse bomb, lit it, and tossed it in over the counter at Leroy, thinking it would be a fun joke. Except the dangerous apparatus landed on some aerial bomb beds, which promptly detonated with the ferocious ricocheting blast that was heard clear down through the cemetery, 2 miles distant. The entire store inventory of holiday explosives joined in the mighty discharge. A local newspaper reporter noted that a box of dung-fused lighters landed over by the school gymnasium." This story is important, and we will revisit it later because it may hold the key to understanding where and how Forrest wove in clues to some of his stories. For now, aside from equivocating his chest to a bomb, let's talk about a term Forrest used when describing the details of his chest and what it might have held. Here are a couple of sketches Eric made of Noah Blake's journal. The bottom one, Eric said, shows the journal in the condition that it was found. And here's some of what we might call confirmation bias. See how that umbilical looking thing in that top sketch stretches across underneath the neck of that ink bottle, making Noah Blake's initials look like an N and a D, rather than an N and a B? Here is an example of the actual journal entries in Noah's diary, alongside Eric's fictional depiction of what life may have been like in 1805, as he laid it out on the page. 19. Mother has begun baking, and the smell is wonderful. It snowed, though not enough to sled Mr. Tom's boards. No word yet from Sarah. 20. A great surprise today. The bell that Father ordered arrived in the village and was drawn by a wagon of four horses, and it took 8 men to lift it down. 21. What a day! They started ringing the bell as we drove to the village. Mother was most surprised, and everyone congratulated Father. I saw Sarah, and when the service was finished, she gave me a folded paper asking me to open it when I got home, which I did. It just said, First Chapter of Ruth, 16. He went to that corner of the barn where an open window cast a ray of light into the hay-filled room. Then he opened the note and read its message. It mystified him, and he went to the house, still wondering. Mother, he asked, where is our Bible? It is where it should be, in the Bible box, said Rachel. Are you going to read it? Who says I can't take it with me? Why do I have to live by everybody else's rules? If I'm going to die of cancer, I'm going to take some stuff with me. And I made up my mind. So I bought this beautiful little treasure chest, 10 inches by 10 inches by 6 inches high. Wonderful Romanesque thing. An antique scholar told me that it was probably Romanesque 11th or 12th century. Maybe it held a Bible or a Book of Days. But it was wonderful. Had a great patina on it. So Forrest's treasure chest may have been a Bible box or held a Book of Days. And what is a Book of Days? It's a journal, a diary, a memoir, an autobiography, etc. And we know how fond Forrest was of Osborne Russell. Here then is something wonderful. Both Eric's book and Forrest's chest, both now and then in their prospective time frames, hold a Book of Days, Noah's diary, and Forrest's memoir. But Eric's book discusses yet another type of Book of Days, an almanac. Farm diaries and almanacs were the books which kept such records. Want to take your cattle on a 3-day trip to the market? Just open your almanac and see when the moon is fullest to make your night travel possible. Did your clock stop, and do you want to set it again? Just open your almanac and find out the minute of sunrise or sunset today. Want to start on a boat trip to deliver your grain? Consult your almanac and find out what hour tomorrow's tide will be the highest. And so it went. In the days when there were no telephones or even neighbors close by, your almanac was far from being a scrapbook of superstitions. It was an absolute necessity. Heavy dew at night means fair, dry day tomorrow. Halo around sun or moon means a lengthy, slow rain within 8 hours. Smoke refusing to rise signifies oncoming storm. Increased odors of swamps, ditches, cellars warns of rain. Rolls of dark clouds under cobwebby sky warns of high wind. Bats and swallows fly near the ground before a rain. On October 19, 2014, Forrest said, Ha! I may be getting old, but my shadow still ain't cast by no fool. On page 129 of The Thrill of the Chase, in the chapter Golden Moor, Forrest wrote, Fortunately, I talked a museum friend into selling me his beautiful cast bronze chest that had three-dimensional female figures on its four sides and on the lid. I know I paid way too much for it, but once in a while something comes along that is so special as to discount all logical rules of value. An excited scholar said the chest was probably a Romanesque lockbox that dated to about 1150 AD. He also thought it might have once held a family Bible or a Book of Days. Now it could hold my ancient jewelry and solid gold pieces. I was delighted. It was the perfect treasure chest. Forrest bought this chest specifically for his treasure hunt. So what is it about this chest in particular that would seduce him enough to be willing to basically write a blank check, for him to be so delighted and to call it the perfect treasure chest? Perhaps it has nothing to do with history or the Middle Ages, but rather the actual letters and a little imagination. On June 26th of 2014, Forrest said, "For instance, emblazoned upon some of the bronze bells I've buried are the words, 'Imagination is more important than knowledge.' If I'd spelled that last word correctly, it would have not had the profundity of meaning I wanted." On April 15th, 2017, Forrest said, "I wrote this someplace a few years ago, and maybe you'll think it's worth remembering. Imagination isn't a technique, it's a key." Sleeping loft ladders were always a challenge to wood craftsmen because there are so many ways to make a ladder. Some ladders folded into one flat, round pole. Others were heavy and permanent, the forerunners of built-in staircases. Some were just pegs driven into the wall. But country boys still found great pleasure in ladders and lofts in the game of pulling the ladder up to protect themselves against imaginary bears or Indians who might come in the open door of the room below. Ben Stahl was another friend. He was the kind of guy you wanted to be around and stay around. We had a show for him, and one of the most popular paintings depicted a cowboy on a ladder who was about to climb into a hayloft. The title was "The Way the West Was Won." We sold it quickly and could have sold it another 10 times over. Ben painted this condensed version and gave it to me. One of Ben's favorite subjects was saloon scenes. They had combustion and usually included ladies who were familiar with the nighttime jingle of spurs. Both Clark and Ben painted subjects that made me feel warm and comfortable. There aren't many artists around today that have that same flavor. The similarities between Eric's ladders and the ladders on Forrest's chest are evident. If Eric's ladder spurred the imagination of young boys, and Forrest's ladders are on his treasure, and imagination is a key, then Eric's ladders are a key to Forrest's treasure. Because it's not about you using your own imagination, it's in the context of how Eric described the imagination of young country boys of early American life that is a key to the treasure. So there are bears at the treasure location, as Forrest implied, but the location is not dangerous because the bears are imaginary. On January 12, 2018, Forrest said, "Grizzly bears alone are something to think about." Notice the candle lit both in front and behind Noah's father. Noah himself looks thinly veiled here and perhaps a little bit embarrassed, having to bathe in what looks to be about a 36-inch bathtub. Well, we're going to continue on from here in a similar fashion, highlighting more or less profound correlations and what I call confirmation markers that will add up to a sort of an overwhelming probability, all the while moving through to the clues in Forrest's poem and where they're at in Eric's book. Oh, and more bombs. From the Thrill of the Chase epilogue, page 147. "Now I feel that my father is sitting on the edge of a cloud somewhere, watching. If he knows everything about me, he's pretty busy lighting candles, some of them at both ends. But I hope he knows that I've been sometimes guilty only by innuendo, and that's why I wrote my epitaph with such profundity. I wish I could have lived to do the things I was attributed to." On September 17, 2013, Forrest said, "Recently, I had a dream in which I inventoried the contents of the treasure chest. I got so excited it woke me up and I couldn't go back to sleep. The map shows the area in which the treasure is hidden, but there's not an X on it. Some of the photos and drawings are a peek back into my early life and the way things used to be when gas was 11 cents a gallon. Others depict a colorful life lived out on the edge, where the cautious and faint of heart fear to go. If someone finds a treasure far into the future, I want them to know who did such an outrageous thing." On November 2nd, 2013, Forrest said, "There are 9 clues in the poem, but if you read the book, there are a couple of good hints, and then there are a couple of aberrations that live out on the edge." Again, on November 2nd, Forrest said, "And I told this writer today she should be writing Encyclopedia Britannicus. It's no fun to read. Everything's there, but it's no fun. I said, when are we going to walk out to the... How do you know where the edge is if you don't go out there and look?" On May 18th, 2017, Forrest said, "In today's society, so many people are going right down the center line, and they never know where the edge is. How do you know where the edge is if you don't go out there and look for, and look and see?" On May 8th, 2017, Forrest said, "I told myself early on that I didn't really want to break any rules, but I'm sure as heck going to stretch the heck out of some of them. How do you know where the edge is if you don't know where to look? To me, rules were a guide. You should follow the rules, generally speaking, unless you have a better idea. And the old saying is, it ain't stupid if it works." Now let's take a look at a journal entry and passage from Diary of an Early American Boy, where we have a couple, Noah and Sarah, going out to the edge to see where the boundaries are and to take inventory. 19. Rog Sunday. After meeting, we all walked our boundaries, met the Adams doing the same. Eric elaborates, "In the evening on Rogation Sunday, farmers and their families walked the boundaries of their property. It was both inventory and time for giving thanks for their land. At points along the way, some boy of the family group was bumped against a marker tree or a boundary stone, or he was ducked into whatever pond or stream marked the boundary. It was all in good fun, and the bumping and ducking was accompanied by a small gift to the boy. In this way, he well remembered the boundaries of the land, which he would someday fall heir to." The Adams family met with the Blakes as both families were walking the boundaries of their land. Noah spotted the Adamses first, probably because he was so eager to see Sarah. "Hi there," he yelled. "Over here are some markers. I guess we are right on the line." "We've bumped Robert on 2 trees already," called out Mr. Adams. "Have you been bumped yet, Noah?" Noah felt he was too old for such childish customs, but just to join in the fun and perhaps to delight Sarah, he allowed himself to be bumped against a pile of marker stones. And it was Sarah who rewarded him with a package of sweet cookies. So here we have an actual couple out on the edge. I included this short section because it's related to edges, boundaries, and borders. Also, it seems the only time Forrest discusses stumps is around this time frame, in The Rendezvous, when he says, "Everything was 1830, exactly 100 years before he was born, and when Noah would have been about 45. Eric would have been 25 because he was born exactly 100 years from 1805. See Too Far to Walk, Chapter 45, page 237, Mountain Man, and The Rendezvous, and Down Eatsel's Archives, or terryscan.com. Both stump pulling and finding hoop wood were spring chores of early times. After the ground had heaved and settled when winter was done, roots were looser, and the big tree stumps were then easier to pull out. The tough roots were almost impossible to burn, so farmers used to push them into a fence formation that wasn't very pretty to look at, but lasted for many more years than an ordinary fence. Even now in Canada and on some remote farms, you will find good root fences, almost a century old. Both Forrest and Noah had a cow named Bessie when they were young boys, and I'm fairly certain Douglas Preston sort of anthropomorphized Forrest Bessie into a character in one of his books. I'd ask him myself, but who am I? On page 31 of The Thrill of the Chase, in the chapter titled Bessie and Me, Forrest wrote, "My father got a Guernsey calf that grew up to be a beautiful fawn-colored animal. We called her Bessie. I loved that old cow, and it was fun to milk her before school and again before supper. She liked me so much she'd swing her tail as a sign of friendship and to swat flies. Until you have loved a cow, part of your soul remains undiscovered." Noah usually grabbed his clothing from its place beneath the covers, tucked it all under his nightshirt, and bounded across the road into the barn before the coldness could catch up with him. Into the barn he would go and make Bessie, the cow, or Daniel, the ox, rise up and move away from their soft spots of hay. Then, standing in the warmed flat spot, he would go about the business of dressing for the day. In the Thrill of the Chase epilogue, page 147, Forrest wrote, "No time spent in thought is wasted, and nothing is too small to know. So one should not let knowing a little bit be a substitute for learning more. The aspirations of youth grow weak where they languish on the shelves of patience. And some of the things I've enjoyed the most in my life have come from the smallest voices. That a butterfly is really a flutterby is one example." And from Noah's journal, 17. "Alarm of frost last night, but no thing was harmed. In spite of the coolness, I saw several hummingbirds and humblebees in the garden." Eric expounds. Here again the author was puzzled by the wording in Noah's diary. Did Noah mean bumblebees? Oddly enough, however, we find that none of the early dictionaries have any mention of bumblebee, but they all do list humblebee. A dog in 1805 could have been a lump of iron, or a fireplace and iron. Fire dog. Looks like a dog. Well, this dog looks like Bip. But the dogs forged by the Blakes were probably this kind. Dogs. Mill dogs, hewing dogs, sawing dogs, used to clamp down the timber to be milled, hewed, or sawed. Dogs. A lot of things were called dogs in the early days, but Isaac probably meant the things that men used to fasten a log with when it was squared or otherwise worked upon. It would seem to be natural to progress from nail making to forging staple dogs, which are like large-sized double nails anyway. It is interesting to note that although these timber dogs were in every household a century or so ago, they have become one of the rarest of tools. The author only has two in his collection. On page 14 of The Thrill of the Chase, in the chapter titled Important Literature, Forrest wrote, "To the caliph I am dirt, to the dirt I am a caliph." And on December 25th of 2015, on mysteriouswritings.com, Forrest wrote, "Plan a warm place in which you can retreat. Merry Christmas." "Get the floor ready for visitors," Isaac would say, and the procedure which followed would amuse anyone of today. Rachel would sweep the hard-packed floor, and then with a stick, she would scratch designs upon it in the manner of a decorative carpet. The Blakes' dirt carpet changed in design according to the occasion. At Christmas, there was a holly design, and on a birthday, there might be a birthday greeting scratch on the floor near the hearth. The whole idea was unending fun, yet even Noah looked forward to the more civilized pleasure of a hard, dry oak plank flooring instead of earth. On June 2nd of 2014, Forrest said, "As far as I know, the closest person to the treasure was a man, but there may have been a woman with him. The most common mistake that I see searchers make is that they underestimate the importance of the first clue. If you don't have that one nailed down, you might as well stay home and play canasta." And just a side note here, the game of canasta was devised in Uruguay, which is where Forrest got some copper nails and used them for his bell clinkers. "Do we nail the boards down soon?" asked Noah. "No," said his father. The trick is just to lay them down loosely so they won't warp. Then you place a roadway going the opposite way across the top. Nails would only split boards and rust the cracks into rot. Loose boards weather best. I know, said Noah, that a good carpenter doesn't use nails unless he has to. I just forgot. If we can do it, said Isaac, with some pride in his voice, we will do it without the use of iron at all. Not even one nail will be used. In the little forge barn halfway down to the bridge, Isaac had earned most of the money needed around the homestead. Not that any early American had a great need for cash, as most things were traded, but a good farmer always had a cash crop or some paying trade other than farming. Isaac was a nail maker. He had taught Noah the art of making hand-wrought nails by letting him pump the bellows of the forge as a little fellow. Now and then he actually hammered or broke the iron nail rods. The reader might be interested in knowing just how wrought iron nails were made and what Noah had to learn about the trade. So this two-page spread of drawings will give you a nutshell lesson in early American nail making. From the Thrill of the Chase, Dancing with the Millennium, pages 135 and 136. What can one person do that might impact life 1,000 years from now? I've given that a lot of thought because the little things can be so important in our lives. For example, do you know how long a piece of iron is needed to make a horseshoe? You measure the horse's hoof, front to back, multiply by 2 and add an inch. Most people don't know that, but I do because my friend Frank Turley told me. And he told me because he's a blacksmith and I paid him $20 to make me one. I just stood there and watched him bellow the coal to heat the metal. The pinging sound of his pounding hammer against iron and anvil was thrilling to me in a romantic sort of way. It had a certain cadence that was an integral part of the total experience, as were the fumes from the forge that permeated the whole episode. I could have just as easily been watching a smithy in the 7th Cavalry shoe a horse. Those things are important, and I'm richer for it. On pages 97 and 98 of The Thrill of the Chase, in the chapter titled My War for Me, Forrest wrote, in order to stay awake, I started playing stupid games, like moving my helmet from left to right, then back, and lightly tapping the canopy on both sides. That helped, but it was distracting, and I didn't want to break anything. Finally, I started moving my left hand in and out, looking at my glove as if I had not seen it before. Then, and for no reason at all, I closed my fist, stuck my thumb out, and moved it close to my face, an inch away from my left eye. My God, I'd completely covered up Philadelphia. I'd covered up millions of people with my thumb. They say that any bridge with a cover on it will last twice as long as one without a cover. Mark my words, every wooden bridge in America will be adding a roof and sides before long. What about covering yours? Isaac read through the account silently and seriously. During the quiet, everyone pondered the new idea, and they had a mind's eye picture of how the new bridge would look, with a house around it. I think it's a good idea, said Isaac. We can put the roof on at first, and then we can add siding before the winter comes. I guess if those Philadelphia builders can have a covered bridge, we can too. Today, covered bridges are treated as a curiosity so antique that many of us believe that they began during the Revolutionary War, or even before that. Yet until the Schuylkill Bridge added its covering in 1805, there were no covered bridges at all in America. The idea took over so quickly, however, it seemed that almost overnight all of our wooden bridges became covered, and the famous early American covered bridge was born. The stories we may hear of how George Washington crossed over this or that covered bridge are, of course, untrue. From here here on out, you will be experiencing very heavy loads for the remainder of the journey. On November 2nd of 2013, someone in the audience asked, "Forrest, did you have 9 clues before you wrote the poem?" Forrest replies, "They're contiguous. I knew where I wanted to hide the treasure, so it was easy for me to put 1 foot down and then step on it to get to the next foot." The drag shoe was released on going down a steep hill with a very heavy load, and the wheel ran right up onto the shoe. The drag shoe, or ruggle, is an obsolete piece of wagon hardware that few people know today. It was hung in front of the rear wheels, and when in going downhill, a heavy load threatened to roll forward and push the horse over, the iron shoe was slid under the wheel, one wheel or both rear wheels, the back part of the wagon became a sled, and the horse actually pulled the load downhill. This, of course, was before the addition of wheel brakes to wagons. From Noah's Journal. 5. Tried the wheel. It is quite true and has great force. Father will begin fashioning the cog wheel. So many searchers are stomping on the ants while the elephants run by. "Goodness," remarked Rachel to her husband, "I don't see why your mill house must be so much better built than our own home. Why, those timbers you are using for framing are big enough to support a herd of elephants." "When the mill begins to operate," said Isaac, "you'll think there is a herd of elephants within the mill. I guess you've never been in a mill house." On February 4th of 2017, Forrest said, "I would advise new searchers to look for the clues in my poem and try to marry them to a place on the map." Just as modern man might enjoy the power and noise of a sports automobile or any mechanical device, the old-time miller derived great satisfaction from the enormous energy that turned the wheel and operated many tons of massive gears. It is the sort of job a man becomes wedded to. And we will marry the clues to a place on the map as we near the end of this presentation. I used a small F because I'm too lazy to hit the shift button. All of this cyberspace verbiage is conspicuous by the absence of talk about where warm waters hold. Several months ago, some folks correctly mentioned the first 2 clues to me in an email, and then they went right past the other 7, not knowing that they had been so close. Alas, and Dame Fortune, so often a fickle and seductive wench, never spun her wheel to lure them back. Hearts. And just a few more general or subtle connections from things Forrest said that are significant to Eric Sloane in Diary of an Early American Boy, Noah Blake, 1805. On May 20th, 2015, Forrest said, "When you open that chest and look at it, your heart's gonna stop. It's gonna be so beautiful." It feels like here Eric's book is the chest on this journey, holding its own important historical book of days and created by one of the few great men Forrest most loved and admired. And I don't even think he could have said something like that without thinking of Eric in this context. Sloane was married 7 times. His last marriage to wife Mimi lasted from age 54 until his 1985 death in New York at age 80. He died from a heart attack while walking down the street to a luncheon held in his honor. A young woman who was a passerby saw Sloane go into cardiac arrest as he held onto a parking meter before collapsing to the sidewalk. She telephoned for help from a nearby phone booth. The luncheon celebration being held in his honor marked the publication of his memoir, published at age 80, entitled 80, An American Souvenir. Even today we find New England harvest tables on the market, not knowing just why they are called that. The first harvest tables were long, narrow tables, such as were reserved for Lammas Day gatherings. These gatherings resembled our present-day Thanksgiving dinners in number and spirit. The tables were always made of one solid plank. From The Thrill of the Chase, Epilogue, page 147. Forrest wrote, "The past will always be contradictory when told by one person at a time. I feel my life has been a rough draft to that place just ahead where the past will come alive again, and all of my experiences and friends through the years will meet with me at the great banquet table of history. There will be no past. Rest in peace, Forrest and Eric. I'm fairly certain you two rapscallions are giving heaven some hell." From The Thrill of the Chase, Dancing with the Millennium, page 137, Forrest wrote, "On many occasions at night, while my wife was watching Dancing with the Stars, I was making wax bells and writing words on them in elevated letters. The latter bronze castings of the bells are exactly like the wax originals I took to the foundry. Bronze is a non-ferrous metal, meaning it won't rust or deteriorate in any way. One must pound it with a sledgehammer or melt it down in order to change its shape. All of my bells were cast in that material so I could bury them. Each one is signed and dated or there'd be no point to the madness. Some of the bells have clinkers that I made from large copper nails taken from 17th century Spanish galleons. Skippy's son, Creighton Fenn, is a professional deep sea diver. He gave the nails to me." April 5th, 2017, from downeatsel.com, scrapbook 172. The Sound of Bells. That's the name of a wonderful book that Eric Sloane wrote in 1966. Later, he bought all the remaining copies from the publisher so he could reissue it into a special bicentennial edition. It never happened, and my copy, a gift from the author, is one of those he wished to modify but didn't. Eric loved bells and noted that under ideal conditions their ring can be heard 9 miles distant. He said, "That faraway sound of a bell could be both forlorn and soul-stirring." Funny I remembered that. He had seen an advertisement. Here are a few old-time church bell codes. Church bells ring at 7 a.m., at 12 noon, and at 9 p.m., curfew. Deaths were told, 6 bells for a woman, 9 for a man. After a pause, the deceased age was told in bells. Births told after 7 a.m. tolling. After 9 p.m. curfew toll, the day of the month in bells was rung. 10 bells for the 10th, etc. In those days, the town bells told of fires and deaths and funerals and holidays and feasts and church events and Indian attacks. Bells were not just for the pleasure. Yet to hear a fine bell peal across the rich countryside is the greatest music to the farmer, and Isaac was a farmer. Here in Eric's depiction of winter on the Blake farm in 1805, you can see that the water wheel has halted. Hence, any other production related to milling has halted as well. Ironically for Noah, his workload has increased because of the completed covered bridge. On December 4th, 2015, Forrest said, "Shut your engine off until spring." On April 22nd of 2016, Forrest said, "Snowy days are a searcher's enemy." From Noah's Journal, "December has arrived with another fall of snow, just enough to cover the ground. Father says it shall be my job to keep the bridge floor in snow. The bridge bears my name, he reminded me." Eric elaborates, "Very few people stop to think how important it was to keep snow shoveled into the old covered bridges. In fact, some believe they were built just to keep out the snow. Yet because most road traffic was during the winter, because of the impassability of muddy summer or spring roads and the ease with which heavy loads could be sledded over snow. The covered bridge's busiest time was sled time. A load of logs stuck in a bridge for a lack of snow on the floor could tie up the traffic badly. Homemade ink recipes. Brown. Boiled down walnut or butternut hulls that have been mashed first. Add vinegar and salt to boil to set. Black. Add indigo or lamp black, suet. Blue. Powdered indigo, 2 parts. 1 part matter, 1 part brawn. Mix with water, let stand, then strain it well. Now those ain't some sort of synesthesia-inducing tea names, but still a nice correlation. Even farmers had their private little canals for hauling heavy loads. A sluice filled with water, a cargo boat floating in it.
3 times it drops.
This overshot type wheel was run completely by gravity, the weight of the water. To me, this is a beautiful cascading waterfall, but seriously, all types of mill wheels require water high to operate. After Rogation Tide Walk, and before the sun had set, the Adams family went back with the Blakes to view the new mill wheel. "What a fine wheel," exclaimed Mr. Adams. "It should give you extraordinary power." "Yes," said Isaac. "It's an overshot wheel, and they say they are the most efficient. With it, we can keep water power locked up in the mill pond till we want to use it. Even when the stream ceases to flow, we can still have water for the mill. The first thing I shall attach to the wheel will be bellows for the forge." Things were sledded during summer by stone boat. Almost no heavy farm loads were hauled on wheels. That was put off till winter when the loads could be slid across the countryside on sled runners. For each wagon the old-time farmer had, he had about 4 sleds. Even smaller stones were thrown on a flat wooden slab known as a stone boat, and slid across the grass during summer, with much less effort than it would take to lift them onto a wagon and cart them on wheels. On November 2nd, 2013, Forrest said, "Out of the night that covers me, dark as the pit from pole to pole, I thank whatever gods may be for my unconquerable soul." Here is how the well sweep helped to build the dug well. And here is the new well with Rachel lowering the bucket. And so a crotched tree was found and a big spruce sweep was pinioned into the crotch. Another spruce pole hung from the sweep tip and a bucket was hung from that. The butt end of the pole was so heavy that it lifted the bucket up, even with water or earth in it. And it was always easier to pull that sweep down by your own natural weight than it would be to pull the loaded bucket up using your strength instead of your weight. Talk about guilty by innuendo, Eric, you rascal. Early American farm life in 1805 depended on water high to create power via gravity and of course to also manage heavy loads by using sluice boxes, as you've seen. Eric mentions heavy loads specifically on numerous occasions throughout Diary of an Early American Boy because early life depended on figuring out ways to move extremely heavy things. And as you can see here, including moving low water high. This horse is named Lightning, and it has a nice blaze on it, don't you think? Now, it ain't a Maverick because it ain't a Mustang. That blaze, though, looks a lot like an arrow. But I think it looks even more so like a bomb plummeting towards Earth. If it is an arrow, it's pointing towards a bridle. Nonetheless, I still would argue that it looks just as much like that bomb shape I outlined from the cover of Diary of an Early American Boy as it does an arrow. On March 3rd of 2013, Forrest said, "I was careful. A blaze can be on a tree, in a fire, on the face of a horse, and a host of others. Life adventures are like thunderstorms. It gets dark, the wind blows, everyone runs for cover. A few people get wet. Then it's gone until the next one. And the survivors are those with the biggest umbrella." Now, a horse is a host of others, and it ain't the thunder people are scared of, it's the lightning. Wagons and covered bridges have good covers. On January 1st, 2014, Forrest responded to the question, what does the word blaze mean in the poem? A horse can have a blaze on its forehead. A blaze can be scraped on a tree to mark one's way. A blaze can mean a flame or a scar on a rock. On June 24th, 2014, Forrest said, the blaze is a physical thing. It's not theoretical. Boy, did I give you a big clue. That's not a clue. I mean, it doesn't take a scientist to figure out the blaze is something you can look at. Nick Lazaredes said, but what is it exactly? Blaze is a collection of something? Forrest replied, a horse has a blaze on his forehead here. I mean, there are rocks that have a white face could be a blaze. I mean, there's a fire that's blazing. I mean, I could give you 1,000 different scenarios, and all of them come to me in by email. Everybody finds a different one. The fact is, the important one is out there. April 29th, 2016, from MysteriousWritings.com. Foxy said, which direction does the blaze face? North, south, east, or west? Forrest replied, I didn't take a radial off the blaze, Foxy. I'm thinking it might not be any of those directions. Just a side note here, the spokes on a wagon wheel are also called radials. On January 17, 2015, on downnitzel.com, scrapbook 125, in an article called Firecracker, Forrest wrote, school was out for the holidays, but all the kids were hanging around the social soda fountain at Smith's and waving past the firecracker stand. The second day, a couple of giggling girls walked up to flirt with the two enterprising businessmen. One purchased a fuse bomb, lit it, and tossed it in over the counter at Leroy, thinking it would be a fun joke, except the dangerous apparatus landed on some aerial bomb beds, which promptly detonated with the ferocious ricocheting blast that was heard clear down through the cemetery, 2 miles distant. The entire store inventory of holiday explosives joined in the mighty discharge. A local newspaper reporter noted that a box of dung-fused lighters landed over by the school gymnasium. I mentioned earlier we were going to return to the passage from Forrest's scrapbook 125 because it may hold the key to understanding how he sprinkled hints into some of his stories. So let's compare it to the following passage from Diary of an Early American Boy, where it looks to me like Forrest cannibalized the story's essence, added his own wonderful creative twist, and then went about hinting about it. Please revisit the Philadelphia Covered Bridge section of this commentary where he appears to have done something similar. Here, cried the auctioneer, is a finer beast as any man would want, and with her goes an almost new wagon. Surely I can get one higher bid. Who will raise it another $5? Just then, someone in the crowd with a little cannon lit the fuse and held his ears. Bang! The cannon exploded only a few feet behind Isaac, and his two hands went over his head as if he were shot. Thank you, Isaac Blake, said the auctioneer. There's a man who knows what he wants. One hand was enough, but he put up two. Sold to Mr. Blake. Well, said Isaac later on, we have a new horse, and he came to us by fate and because of a toy cannon. I don't know what they called him before, but I have a name for him now. It shall be Bang. Both Eric's and Forrest's stories are somewhat sensationalized with similar nomenclature. Fuses, bombs, blasts, bangs, fireworks, cannons, etc. So let us not forget Forrest said on a few separate occasions that he knew his treasure chest was a bomb. But he didn't know it had a fuse. Interestingly, the word cannon in Spanish is spelled C-A-N-O-N and pronounced like the English canyon. Here's the definition from Google Translate, which is more like a list of synonyms. El canyon, cannon, canyon, barrel, gun, tube, gorge. Noah's father happens to be describing a toy cannon. I can't help but think about that title to the story, My Spanish Toy Factory, on pages 32 and 33 of The Thrill of the Chase, where guess what? It ain't about Spanish toys. And how about this next passage where Forrest describes how Peggy named his car the Bullet in an almost identical way, but with a twist, that Noah's father named his horse Bang. During the day, I curled up on the back seat and dreamed about my beautiful Plymouth. It had no safety glass in the windows, no air conditioner or radio, no power steering or power brakes, and no power windows or turn signals. I stuck my arm out when I wanted to turn. Straight out meant left, and straight up meant right. I felt like I was bragging every time I signaled a turn, but I could lever that windshield up when I wanted ventilation. Peggy named my wonderful car the Bullet, because she said it was shot. On May 28th of 2014, someone asked Forrest, is the blaze one single object? He responded, in a word, yes. I learned his name was Dal Neitzel, and that he had worked with my nephew Creighton Fenn, who is a professional deep-sea diver. He found the Agamemnon, Lord Nelson's flagship, and brought a cannon up. But Dal Neitzel was working with my nephew when they found, I think, 79 17th century sunken Spanish galleons off the coast of Uruguay. I mean, Dal Neitzel, his water runs deep, and he's a really neat guy, too. Now, after reading this passage about Dow and contemplating all these explosive correlations, connections, and parallels, I've come to one final conclusion, despite what he says here, and that is that Forrest probably didn't even like Dow, only kept him around because of his big guns and was cheap muscle. On April 15th, 2017, Forrest wrote, well, Pony immediately recognized the artist's style, palette, and subject and personality. She wasn't impressed, and as if possessed by the spirit of Thor, she turned to face me. Is that what you called me down here for? To look at that thing? Her face looked unsympathetic as her nose pointed toward the 17th century wooden door to my office, beside which one must pass to exit, and out she strode, the sensitive Mr. Grant following in close trail. Neither of them even said goodbye. Gulp. The horse imagery Forrest uses when describing Pony and her friend is hilarious. But please lend your attention to the last sentence, which is only one word. Gulp. Because I want to make sure you recall from the passage we discussed earlier describing the cannon shot that scared Noah's father, when Eric used the same exclamatory one-word technique, bang. Also in this passage, in the second to the last sentence, neither of them even say goodbye compares nicely with the last sentence in this next passage when Eric says, without the slightest sort of departing gesture, and I'm pretty sure you'll see why it's important. Indians don't use chairs, said Isaac, and if we want to be gracious hosts, we must sit on the ground with them. So Rachel and Isaac and Noah spent a good part of the afternoon doing what they never dreamed they would ever be doing. Sitting on the bare ground, eating and drinking with guests. Noah laughed openly at the scene and everyone seemed to have a good time, yet the Indians, who appeared never to have learned to laugh or even smile, did nothing but eat. Suddenly, the two Indians stood up and left without the slightest sort of departing gesture. And remember that picture of four sitting Indian style on the bare ground drinking a beer at San Lazaro? Perhaps out of respect and perhaps a hint. Here we have the end of the scene again, along with how Noah documented it in his journal. Suddenly, the two Indians stood up and left, without the slightest sort of departing gesture. 12. Two Indians came by from the mountains on their way to the village. We fed them. They marveled at our new bridge. So the Indians ate and abruptly left, tarrying not, and then marveled at the bridge on their way out. Isaac puts a brush atop the new structure. the King Post Truss. For a longer bridge, two King Posts create a Queen Post Truss. Another ancient custom is seen in Isaac's putting a brush on top of the new structure. Even nowadays, you will see workmen put a small tree or bush on the top of a new roof when it has been completed. That ceremony always calls for a round of drinks for the builders, and although we don't seem to know why we do it, we say it is just to give the house luck. That tree tacked atop of a new building goes all the way back to Druid lore, when men worshiped trees. On September 29th, 2015, Forrest said, "One of our tall cottonwood trees was maimed by a lightning strike and lost a big limb. I saw the whole thing. I was just standing there at our kitchen window watching. So now when there's thunder, Peggy and I and little Tesk run for cover." Peggy's grandmother once told me that just a millisecond before lightning hits, the hair on the back of my neck will stand up. It's a static electricity phenomenon, she claimed. When that happens, lightning is about to hit nearby with a jolt. But if I jump really high, maybe it will hit the ground while I'm still in the air, thus saving me from the fiery bolt. Of course, I don't know if that's true. She also said you shouldn't plant a weeping willow tree because when it gets big enough to cover your grave, you'll die. However, Peggy and I have such a giant willow that we planted as a seedling in 1988, and we're still vertical. Makes me suspicious of grandmotherly wisdom. November 11th, 2015, downeetzel.com, scrapbook 148. Forrest wrote, "Soon I'll plant 200 pine saplings. There is always hope when old men plant young trees. Don't hail when north winds blow too soon across my pine trees, tall and lean. Let's keep the warming days of June. Blueberries are red when they're green." August 16th, 2019, downeetzel.com, scrapbook 204. Forrest wrote, "It was not unusual for black bears to be eating berries on bushes within short walking distance from us. When that happened, Mom would start singing. Dad said to leave them alone if they moved toward us, just give them space. There were plenty of berries to go around. That was in the 1930s and early 40s. I never heard of anyone being hurt by a black bear up there. Meeting a grizzly was different, but it was not something we worried about. If one ever wandered in to command the berry bushes, we surely would have retreated at a nervous pace. We never had to. Those were fun family times." From Noah's Journal, 20. "Mrs. Adams and Sarah went berrying and visited us. They reported seeing a bear among the berry bushes, so I accompanied them home where they showed me how to make blackberry wine." Eric elaborates, "An early 19th century recipe for blackberry wine was found by the author of this book. It seems very simple to make. It had the amusing title, A Medicinal Drink for Summer Affections, and it read as follows. May 18th, 2014, downeetzel.com, scrapbook 69. Forrest writes, "Occasionally I get an email from a searcher who presents a different twist to the story. I always get permission before forwarding it to Dow to post. This is one of those. Please don't misunderstand me. I'm not hinting that the treasure is hidden on top of a rock with a bear guarding it." The rocking chair, an American invention. Most rocking chairs were plain chairs with rockers added in the late 1700s. The Pilgrim type, 1690 to 1700. The Comeback Windsor, 1790 to 1805. The Slat Back Ladder Rocker for Sarah Trowbridge, 1805. The Pennsylvania, 1790. The Giant Dutch Rocker from 1800. And the Cradle Type Rocker from 1765. On November 2, 2013, at the Moby Dickens Bookshop interview in Taos, New Mexico, the first thing Forrest said was, "Well, I always thought I deserved a throne." "Do you think she will like to have her own chair?" asked Noah. Rachel herself had always wanted a rocker, so she was being honest. "I cannot imagine a nicer present." Rockers were not exactly new in 1805, but nearly all of them were converted chairs. Most of the rockers at that time were slat-backed chairs with oversized rockers exactly like those beneath a child's cradle. It is quite possible that in 1805 the rocking chair was only 25 years old. Its origin is not certain, but it is American, possibly the only completely American piece of furniture. On May 4th, 2017, Forrest said, "Stop armchairing that thing to death and get out there in the trees where the box is. But before you go, look at the poem as if it were a map, because it is, and like any other map, it will show you where to go if you follow its directions." On October 7, 2016, Forrest said, "If you have a searching partner, best to have them wait in the car." Here we are back at the covered bridge prior to its completion. Now, I never read $17 a square inch, but I do know Eric Sloane and Forrest wanted to build a covered bridge because it's highlighted in the book's summary. Anyone remember when Forrest advised folks to sell? "Father," cried Noah, "there's a big wagon at our bridge." Isaac came running, and soon he and Noah were exchanging greetings with the driver, who had gotten down from the large covered wagon painted blue and filled with wares to sell. The sides were made like chests of boxes, and each little door opening into a store of different articles, and each door with a title upon it. The sides of the wagon were like chests of boxes. In Too Far to Walk, Forrest said this old relic of an ammunition wagon could have been one of the wagons that dug ruts in the Santa Fe Trail, perhaps even making the 900-mile pilgrimage from Independence, Missouri to downtown Santa Fe. He said it now stands sentinel alongside that historic trail, not far from the Sangre de Cristo Mountains, in rock-throwing distance from his library window. Mr. Green's Cider Mill. Fresh apples. Stones turned by water wheel or horse. These runners turned on at Chase. Look at the size of these stone wheels called runners. I'd bet my last peanut that the thrill never ended watching these guys chase each other round and round, year after year. Hey, anyone know what's black and sticky and looks like it's running? Like I said in the beginning, I think the true treasure that Forrest wanted everyone to find is Eric Sloane's book, Diary of an Early American Boy, Noah Blake, 1805. The clues in the poem sure do seem to be in there, this 9-chapter book. Nonetheless, I did promise we would have an opportunity to marry the clues to a map, and here it is. Eric's 4-page pull-out map located in between page 80 and 81 is a good map. As you can see, it highlights both the old farm prior to the upgrades and the new farm after the bridge and mill were completed 15 years later. The Blake Place, 1790. This was the year when Noah was born, the year after Isaac Blake and his wife Rachel built their cabin near Red Man Brook. The bark roofs, the clay and stick chimney, and the temporary lean-to barn were all replaced. Look at the next picture and see what changes occurred. The Blake Place, sometime after 1805. With the help of Noah, Isaac Blake had created a workable homestead. The Indian Trail became a roadway. The brook became a source of power to grind corn that grew where once a forest stood. The shelter became home to an early American boy. Now, if this gives you any ideas, before you start typing things into Google, please stay with me a while longer, and let's talk about something hard. In so doing, we'll be reviewing what Forrest said to help us narrow down the massive 4-state search areas into something more reasonable. Let's start by doing some basic housekeeping with this quote. Some searchers overrate the complexity of the search. Knowing about head pressures, foot pounds, acre feet, Bible verses, Latin, cubic inches, icons, fonts, charts, graphs, formulas, curved lines, magnetic variation, codes, depth meters, riddles, drones, or ciphers will not assist anyone to the treasure location. Although those things have been offered as positive solutions, excellent research materials are the thrill of the chase, Google Earth, and/or a good map. On March 26, 2011, Forrest said, "I gave a really good clue to a friend the other day, and I'll give it to you because it's very important. that the treasure chest is more than 400 miles west of Toledo. On May 13, 2011, report from Santa Fe with Lorene Mills, Forrest said, "I'll give you a clue for your readers. The chest is more than 300 miles west of Toledo." Mills responds, "Okay," laughing. Forrest then says, "And it's not in Nevada, so those are big clues." Mills replies, "Okay then. Well, and we want people to have the thrill of the chase." On May 11, 2013, Forrest said, "I like the way you put that. The Today Show had me to come on one time a month for 2 minutes on the Today Show and give additional clues, and I agreed to do that. But those clues are not going to take anybody to the treasure chest. The first clue that I gave was that it's above 5,000 feet above sea level. The entire Rocky Mountains is higher than that. So, and another clue I gave is that it's more than 300 miles west of Toledo. But that leaves a lot of places to search there also. And for the next 8 or 9 months, I will continue to give clues like that. But don't expect them to take you to the treasure chest." On August 8th, 2013, Forrest said, "I've given clues to everybody. I've never given a clue to an individual. The first clue that I gave that wasn't in my poem was because I made this guy mad and he demanded another clue. And I said, the treasure chest is hidden more than 300 miles west of Toledo. I don't think he knew that I was pulling his leg. There was a guy out there someplace, dug a hole 18 inches deep and 9 inches wide, and they arrested him." On December 15, 2013, on DownEasel.com, Forrest gets crazy mail. Beaker said, "Forrest, there's a guy on Dow's blog that says he's going to Terre Haute, Indiana to look for the treasure because it's 300 miles west of Toledo because he thinks you like basketball and Larry Bird. Beaker." Forrest replies, "Beaker, that's true, so what's the problem?" On May 29th, 2015, on the Richard Eeds Show, Forrest said, "Well, this lady called me on the phone and she said, 'Mr. Fenn, I've studied your poem and I've looked at your clues. I just can't figure it out. You've got to help me. I need something else.' I said, 'Lady, I'll give you a clue. The treasure is more than 300 miles west of Toledo.' And she said, 'Well, thank you, Mr. Fenn. I really appreciate it.' And she hung up the phone just as happy as a bumblebee." On September 14th of 2015, on Forrest's second appearance on the Richard Eeds Show, he said, "Well, it's in the Rocky Mountains north of Santa Fe. It's interesting that you mention that because this lady from Minnesota called me on the phone and she said, 'Forrest, you have to help me a little bit.' And I said, 'Okay, I'll give you another clue.' I said, 'The treasure is more than 300 miles west of Toledo.' And she thought for a minute, 'Oh, thank you, Forrest.' She thought I was really helping her. She was satisfied." Before we take a look at how this looks on a map, let's look at another quote from Forrest about his understanding of directions and compass headings. These are some wonderful questions from Mr. Lazaredes, and I'm so grateful he asked them. Lazaredes said, "I just wanted to ask you again about a couple of the clues. I mean, one of the things we're talking about this morning was the definition of north. North of Santa Fe, and that seems to be an issue of contention, but not for you. How would you describe north?" Forrest says, "Well, I'm going to look it up and find out for sure, but north, a northerly direction to mean anything north of 270 degrees and north of 090 degrees. In other words, half of the universe is in a northerly direction, and the same is true for south." Lazaredes says, "So anything above Santa Fe longitude?" Forrest replies, "271 degrees to me can be a northerly direction." So he's not talking about longitude and latitude at all. He's talking about compass headings from a specific location. Like this 270 degree west Google Earthline heading from Toledo. However, it doesn't do us much good when he tells us it's 300 or 400 miles west of Toledo, unless it is exactly 270 degrees west from Toledo. Given the information we have so far, it could still be anywhere in the search area. Again, unless it's somewhere within the search area at exactly 270 degrees west of Toledo, this would rule out a few states and narrow down the search area significantly. Of course, he did not specify exactly 270 degrees west of Toledo, but way back in August of 2011, the day after his birthday, he did rule out Montana, Wyoming, and northern Colorado when he says the following. On August 23rd, 2011, Forrest wrote, "Every day people call me begging for clues. The other day, I had 21 email requests. One man asked if he should buy a topographical map, and I told him he'd be better served reading the book again. All you have to do is think about the 9 clues and follow them in order. Okay, I'll tell you what I told a woman from Nevada who called and said she knew where the treasure was, but was incapacitated, so would I please go get it for her? I said, well, you tell me where it is and I'll bring it to you. The woman wanted an additional clue, so I told her it was more than 300 miles southwest of Toledo. By telling us it's southwest of Toledo, which is anything south of 270 degrees west of Toledo, he definitively rules out the 2 most northerly states in the search area. Now, I know this is hard for a lot of folks, but just over a year later, he narrows the search area down even further and shows us where the lines cross. On October 2nd, 2012, Forrest says, "The treasure chest certainly is in the mountains somewhere north of Santa Fe, and that is a clue. That is not to say it's exactly 360 degrees from Santa Fe, but generally, if you start chasing horseshoes, you may go crazy, but it's the thrill of the chase, remember? Other clues I have given but are not commonly known are, it's not in Nevada, and it is more than 300 miles west of Toledo, but those won't help you much. Good luck." Here again, Forrest definitively rules out Yellowstone and Cody, even without the Toledo clue, and even if he gave us a 10-plus degree margin of error. But he didn't. Many times over, Forrest said it was straightforward, and you can clearly see here, neither Yellowstone or Cody are anywhere near 360 degrees north of Santa Fe. Yellowstone is at 343 degrees, and Cody is at 346 degrees. The lines cross here, but there are many different scenarios depending on what you believe. If you think Forrest was pulling your leg when he said he agreed to say it was in Wyoming, but you believe it when he said it was southwest of Toledo and generally 360 degrees north of Santa Fe, then this map will help you, especially if you're looking anywhere at least a mile from and just about straight south of Mount Guyot in Colorado. Maybe you believe Forrest was sincere when he said he agreed to say it was found in Wyoming, but was pulling your leg about the Toledo clue, yet you still believe his clue was about it being generally 360 degrees north of Santa Fe. Well, like we saw earlier, this does rule out Yellowstone and Cody, but the southeasterly area of Wyoming is still in play. However, any part of Montana is not. If you take another look at this map from too far to walk, you'll see why. Perhaps you think Forrest was pulling your leg when he said he agreed to say it was in Wyoming, yet you still believe the southwest of Toledo clue, but you think he gave the generally 360 degrees north of Santa Fe clue in jest. Then all of northern New Mexico is in play, as well as a large portion of southern Colorado. Now, if you believe it when Forrest said he agreed to say the treasure was found in Wyoming, and yet believe none of the other clues he mentioned, well, there are a lot of fun areas you can research with this information in mind. You might start by Googling Old Indian Trail in Wyoming. And I think I will stop it here. If I told you, I'd have to shoot you.